Yeah. Could I just go back in time, Gerard?
Yeah. There. Like any time.
You went to NCAD in Dublin.
Yeah.
And then you went abroad a little, and then you went to New York. Did you get a PS1 scholar? Was that what brought you to New York?
It's not what brought me to New York, but I did it in the time I was in New York.
When you were there.
I was in New York for about 6 years.
6 years, okay. And it was very important to you, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was really formative, I think. Everything is formative, you know, especially when you're young. So NCAD was formative in its own way. But New York was really formative. I think the idea of just proximity to things, proximity to contemporary art was very important. I think.
While you were there, you had a show here in, was it 2000, where there was a set of photographs of like interiors at night in New York.
Yeah.
Would you talk a bit about those? Because they made quite an impact here. They were.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's funny because they're, I haven't shown them that much. I showed them a lot like in those years, and I didn't show them then. I didn't deal with them much for a long time. I wasn't working on it. And then recently I actually have been revisiting them. They're photographs that I made going around New York at night, going around mostly Manhattan, but also the other boroughs, and noticed that they've, for whatever reason, they leave the lights on in these empty spaces, big plate glass windows. And I was interested in the sort of, the pictorial qualities, you know, I was interested in how these things looked. And I was also interested in ideas of private space, public space, what I was allowed to photograph. I often had confrontations with security guards and various stuff like that, and that all filtered into the work. But also basic ideas of an interior, and then there was always a lot of kind of reflections on the glass and ideas of different layers of imagery and or ideas of what was stable and unstable, what was legible and illegible within the image. So
they're very good photographs technically, even though they're quite simple in a way. But people say now that artists don't learn how to do anything, you know, that
right.
What do you learn in art school? But it's noticeable that in your work, although you haven't used conventional media very much, what you do use, you know very well how to use technically.
Yeah.
Is that a consideration then for you?
Well, I think it's important that, I think if you're interested in, as you mentioned at the beginning and then I reinforced, if you're interested in kind of connecting to certain types of discourses or certain idioms, you know, certain ways of representing, then it's important that you do that adequately. It's not about mastery or perfectionism, but it is about adequacy, you know. And so, the black and white photographs that I showed at the beginning of the newsstands, I mean, on some level, they're extremely modest images. They're photographed in the most kind of rudimentary kind of compositional manner you could imagine, but there's also some very, very specific kind of decisions gone into them, even down to how they're made. They're made in a dark room and they're one-off prints, so there's not a digital file and then a digital print or something that could be produced in multiplicity. They're made one at a time and they're unique prints, and so there's very specific relationships engendered there between one single photographic artwork and a multiplicity of like magazine imagery that it tends that it tries to speak to or speak against or to. So I think it's all about adequacy. It's all about just finding the tools and the means that are fit for the purpose.
So then you have this thing where you're clearly technically very good at doing things. You can do all these things very well, and then In that very important piece of yours, It's Time for Imperial Again, you made a really bold decision that seems completely counterintuitive, to do this sort of alienated version of the advertorial acted out in this sort of slightly disjointed way that doesn't fit with the original. But where did that idea come from?
Well, actually, it's interesting because there's, you know, the work is made, that work is edited in a way that there's the dialogue that the actors recite It takes them about 7.5 minutes to get through that text, those three pages of the magazine. And it's looped three times, and each loop is a different edit. And part of that came down to the fact that I didn't really know how to edit. and secondly, it seemed to me that, I think there's always a kind of struggle there a little bit, where on the one hand you're trying to polish something to a degree where it seems to, as I say, connect to an idiom or to a kind of form. And on the other hand, it's also important to somehow try and keep it open. So make it legible and at the same time not make it like too palatable.
Yeah, too cozy or contained.
Yeah, so yeah. There's kind of ways in which I suppose on the most basic level, right, you can kind of introduce strategies into how you make some decisions that you make. Literally, I'm not trying to mystify the production of making a work here, literally very immediate decisions about edits, for example. Or choosing between different types of shots or whatever. Or having something that, as I said earlier, is kind of a mistake. Can you decide whether to cut it or leave it?
Yeah.
That's all part of this kind of process in a way of kind of making a work that feels like it sort of opens out things, brings people in and also opens things out.
Yeah, makes them question things as well.
As I say, so making use of television, for example, as a form, and at the same time undermining.
When you found that text, did the idea come from that text, or were you looking for a text in that way to use?
Well, it's funny, I had a conversation with somebody earlier today about ideas of serendipity, in terms of me finding that material looking for material, or artists finding things. We're talking about artists tonight. So artists, for example, finding things, gravitating towards certain types of source imagery or reference points or something. And I think it's not about serendipity, of course, luck is a factor, but it's more about, I think a lot of it is about a sensibility. It's about kind of knowing what something is when you find it. It's about, happening upon something and realizing that this somehow speaks to or answers certain needs or requirements that you have. And so on some level, it might seem like very happenstance. And on another level, it's actually much more complicated than that.
Sort of, you realize when you find it, but you're not quite sure why. But
I think often you're not really sure what it is you're looking for. I can talk, and I'm aware of the fact that tonight I'm trying to speak quite analytically about how I make work. And as I said, I it's not mysterious, but it has a sort of, but it's also not something that's totally engineered. There's a sort of idiosyncratic character to artistic production that I think is really important, even at the same time, if it's not necessarily all that mystical.
Mm. In making that work, and indeed in many works since, you're sort of like a film director as well.
Yeah.
How did you find that?
Well, it's funny because it's something that I just found myself having to do that. So for example, I had this idea, this kind of conceptual idea, which is that I had these texts and I wanted to have actors speak these texts all the texts actually are transcripts to begin with. So you have this idea of the spoken word that's transcribed and published, and then you have this process of reiterating that text as a way of testing it, actually, of testing the text. And so that was my concept, right? And that was what I needed to do. And so I got together the tools I needed for that. So camera, actors, whatever. And then I realized that they all expected me to direct them, which I wasn't at all an aspiration, and continues to not be an aspiration of mine. But at this point, I'm pragmatic enough to realize that in order to get the production done, that people expect me to play that role.
Yeah.
And so that's what I do.
Yeah. And I mean, since then, you've done a lot of quite complicated direction in that sense. And there are quite complicated performances in a lot of your work as well, on the part of the actors, which is interesting. And you've used many actors who are actors as well.
I'm talking about it in a kind of, I'm kind of downplaying things a bit, but I, I, But at the same time, you know, I've always been amazed at what actors have brought to the
right.
occasion.
Yeah.
And I've worked with some people I've worked with a lot of people who've really been quite amazingly talented. And you know, it's interesting because sometimes their brilliant work is to the benefit of my production. There's been occasions where I feel like, in a way, it's sort of run contrary to what I need.
You're too brilliant.
But that's something, that's kind of one of those things, right?
Yeah.
That you, one of those complications that you deal with. It's the same with, like, you know, camera work or cinematography or something. Mm. Is that, as I say, I'm interested in adequacy as the kind of basic kind of benchmark. It needs to be good enough to be able to do what I need
what
it
I need
to do.
To do yeah.
And at the same time, you know, I've had people do kind of virtuoso virtuoso efforts and it's brilliant. And then at the same time, you wonder if actually it starts to pull the work off in a direction that's not ultimately what you're trying to do.
Sure. Where was It's Time for Imperial Again first seen?
I showed it actually the first kind of, I made it in the late 90s when I was just finishing my time in New York. And I think I might have screened it, but the first time in one or two places, but the first time I actually showed it in its final form as an installation was actually in IMA
really?
In 2002.
Yeah.
So actually it was several years after I'd made the work, and that part of the reason why there was that big delay was because I moved back to Ireland in the meantime, and I wasn't a complete stranger here, but I didn't know a lot of people, and more importantly, people didn't know what I was doing for the most part, and so there wasn't really that many opportunities to show the work until this show in 2002 in IMA, a group show that they did.
Right.
That Annie Fletcher curated, and then actually the work was shown, you know, quite a lot. Then after that, it got kind of picked up, you might say.
So. That's what I was going to ask. Did it get picked up immediately? Yeah.
It was very fortuitous for me that the day after the show opened in IMA, these curators from the Manifesta Biennial came to Dublin for a day. To do research, and somehow they went to IMA the day after the show opened, and they saw the work, and I think they somehow through some sort of network they had it was a little bit like this idea is that they kind of knew they'd heard something about this work,
okay.
And then it suddenly miraculously kind of appeared before their eyes in IMA, and so they included it in that Manifesta show, which opened like 2 months later.
I think
I was the last artist invited to the biennial. and it was very well received in the biennial, and so then it sort of circulated very widely from there, and I guess that was a really important moment for me in terms of like working in Europe, you know.
Yes.
Because I actually really had no connection to sort of continental Europe, as we call it, before
then. Yeah, to then, yes, yeah. But I've noticed that seeing your work abroad, that it reaches cross-culturally very well, in that people from most countries can really latch on very quickly to what you're doing, which is interesting, isn't it?
You'd say with a lot of visual arts that should feel feasible or possible, but obviously my work is most of the work is very directly bound to language.
Yeah.
And in that sense, you know, there's very immediate kind of constraints or issues to deal with. And so within that context, I think that your point is very well made. That it's interesting to see how the work can speak, you know, can work in different contexts, and it works differently, certainly, context to context. I guess there's a sense in which you've got a certain gallery going audience.
Yes. Yeah.
That's quite, in a way, cosmopolitan, or at least sort of pan-European, or internationalist, and you know, and in a way, it's quite a narrow audience, but it's spread quite evenly, you know, on some level, or spread widely, we'll say, you know.
Yeah.
So in that sense, you can see that how it can work.
You've made a work that looks at the myth of the Loch Ness Monster.
Yeah.
What drew you to that?
Yeah, I'm sorry I didn't show it any of it tonight. Just again, it's just a question of trying to be efficient. But I made a project about the Loch Ness Monster, about Loch Ness and the Loch Ness Monster, which I worked on and off over like more than a decade, beginning in 2001, I think. And it's basically a photographic project that on some level for people who haven't seen it, it's mostly just photographs, black and white photographs for the most part, taken around Loch Ness, some kind of landscapey. Taken by me. Yeah. A lot of ones that are of kind of very specific details of things around the lake, other images that play around with kind of optical effects and stuff like that. But it's sort of a range of different materials. But the starting point was really an interest in the idea of Loch Ness as a kind of important site within a history of photography, as this kind of site of kind of fantasy for photography. I mean, we all know that there's a little genre or sort of minor history of photographs of the Loch Ness Monster, hoaxes, real, whatever, you know. I'm a non-believer, by the way. But I'm interested in that. I was interested in that history, and I was interested in how that history spoke of certain fantasies about what photography could be in the 1930s, which is when the whole Loch Ness Monster myth really kind of kicked off, actually, late 1932. And it was also, again, that was a myth that was driven by newspapers and for newspaper circulation. And so it's interesting to think about the relationship between news media and newspaper circulation and this kind of a desolate area in the Highlands of Scotland.
Mm. Yes, yeah.
So that was really the original context. And the project on some level was very much, very much about ideas of photography and how photography could or couldn't represent things. How can you represent something that doesn't exist? The idea of like something standing in place of something else. Ideas of analogy and analog. These a lot of ideas like that were at play. When you have a project that you work on over a long time like that, it always ends up being a kind of compounds multiple different ideas or a kind of cluster of different concerns.
Sure, yeah.
And is quite difficult to streamline it.
You do that with other things as well, don't you? You begin projects and they sort of take their own sort of pace and shape.
Yeah, I mean, I think especially with photographic work, I mean, even like the newsstand photographs I said at the beginning, I've been making them since about 2006. And part of what's important about that for me is the idea that I have these projects, these mostly photographic projects, that I can kind of make on my own terms.
Mm.
Mostly. I can make them on my own time scale.
Oh, yeah.
I can make them, as I say, really on my own terms. Whereas a lot of the kind of installation, video installation work, it's very obvious you're working with a bunch of people, with a team of people, and you're working usually to a deadline.
Yeah.
There's constraints.
Sure, and they're very expensive as well, too.
Yeah, I mean, it's not something that I particularly like about them is that they're expensive to make. I mean, I don't have any aspirations to kind of big budget production, but and again, it's back to that old question of what do you need to do for it to be adequate, you know?
Yeah.
And what does it cost to make something that feels adequate? Like I did this thing with RTE 2 years ago. I just mentioned it. Actually, there's a sort of image on the back of the handout that references it. It actually wasn't a huge budget thing at all. I mean, and RTE were very helpful in the realization of it, but it involved like shooting something in a TV studio with multiple cameras and once you get into something like that, then suddenly you're working and you've got like 40 people working on the production, because there's all these people with different little jobs to do, it's like 40 people or 35 people, whatever. And And that's, it's not something I love, but that's, you know, I wanted to make something that looked like a TV program. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how it works.
Yeah. Briefly, we saw a bit of your video on minimalism, which is a thing as a whole in a space where it isn't. I think
a thing is a whole in a thing it is not.
In a thing is it not? Yeah. And I thought that was, did that have its first showing in Lismore Castle, or was it shown before that?
Actually, it was actually shown simultaneously in two spaces.
Okay, at the same time. Yeah.
Actually, there was a few days apart, but essentially they opened the same time. So Lismore Castle was one of the locations, and the other one was in Glasgow. It was the Glasgow International Festival, and they were two of the co-commissioners for the project. Oh, yeah. There was two other spaces involved, the Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven in Holland and the Renaissance Society in Chicago in the US. And they all co-produced the work. And yeah, as I said briefly, a lot of it was shot in a museum, shot in the Van Abbe Museum. And
yes.
I mean, I could characterize it really briefly as saying a lot of it is about how these minimalist sculptures, how they actually exist within the institution of the museum, how they exist as kind of completed works, how they exist in storage, how they exist in their assembly or disassembly. So that's one strand of the project. There's multiple strands.
Yeah. Again, there was a recording that you reenacted between minimalist artists.
Yeah.
And
the radio interview.
I think what's really interesting about that is the two things that you have, the work being installed in the museum, and it's clearly kind of, I wouldn't say fragile, but it's clearly ephemeral, temporal work that has its own kind of temporality. Whereas like the idea, again, that you have of minimalism as it's like this final endpoint, this fixed eternal thing, that's something that recurs in things you do, isn't it? That things are not actually an endpoint or a fixed or an absolute. They're always within their own time and their own conceptual space, which will change. Mm-hmm. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm interested in the idea that relationships are constellations of things. Mm. Of course, aren't fixed, are relative, right? And so, like most conspicuously, like just to refer back to the talk, I talked about this project 1984 and beyond, which was a kind of a speculation about a past speculation about a future that's now past.
Mm. Yeah.
If you can follow that, right? So, you know, so you've got, and I think as you mentioned at the beginning of the talk, something that I didn't really follow up on, but this idea is quite important to me, this idea of how an artwork exists in time and how that shifts over time, how its existence in time shifts over time, and how, you know, it can speak to a certain moment, and whether it can kind of retain the capacity to speak subsequently, or whether it loses that, or it changes, or, you know, because of course a relationship with artworks, for example, is never fixed. I mean, you know, like what we see in the galleries here in the National Gallery. I mean, we see, you know, there's a configuration there that manifests, certain ideas of artist history. Mm. But of course, we all know that that's been revised, you know, in time over the duration, the existence of the museum itself. And that's just in this one museum. But if we see it as a more generalized condition, we realize that actually history is something that we actively kind of produce, and we produce it for our own needs. Yes. You know,
I thought that came across very clearly in your film, where you have the technicians installing the work in the Van Abbe Museum, because you have this notion of the museum as a kind of fixed place with a canon. But actually, it's not at all. Museums are a relatively recent invention, and they changed a lot in evolving to where they are now. And there's no reason to think that they will stay where they are now.
Yeah,
as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an interesting point, because it touches on something that I think that I'm aware has been a pattern across like the discussion so far this evening, which is which is concerns about like temporality, right? And about the idea of time, not in both in the sort of absolutist sense, but also in the immediate sense of the artwork and its existence in the museum. And I think the reason why, I've been thinking as we've been talking about why is that important? And I think it's important because I think, you know, one of the things about visiting a museum or visiting a gallery is that it really is quite a defined, tangible kind of temporal investment, right?
Yes, yeah.
You know, I mean, now it's got to the point like where TV is not something that you watch the show when it suits you to watch it, right? You don't have to be there at 9 o'clock to catch the 9 o'clock news. You kind of watch it when it suits you, or where you want it. You watch it wherever you want to watch it. You know, there's a sort of slippage that's there that's increasing, that's just become like increasingly the norm. Mm. And I think that the idea of like physically being present in a museum or a gallery space and physically present for a kind of tangible amount of time is something that that is on one level kind of quotidian and just the way it is, but it somehow has taken on a kind of increasing prescience as that becomes an increasingly kind of increasingly less obvious way to kind of spend your time or something. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, what I was going to ask you was, because on your works are installed in museums and there you go and see them, yet in another way, when you look at it, it's quite extraordinarily well suited to the age of the internet and that thing, as you say, that freedom from physical presence and being there, because it's so treatable in terms of imagery that you promulgate. How do you feel about that? Is that you're still very committed to the idea?
Yeah, I'm really aware of those of what you're saying. I'm really aware of the fact that it would seem very, very obvious to sort of circulate work or disseminate work through other means. Like, I just heard the other day was like the anniversary of the founding of the internet or something last week.
Yeah.
And somebody, I heard on the radio on RT or something, that there's like 6 trillion web pages or something like that. And my website is one page. It's one page. It's a complete cop out in terms of using that as a platform.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, I'm not making too much of that, but I've made very kind of committed decisions to work with the gallery as a kind of context. And I think that it's somehow important.
So it is important that the person is there in the space and going through the real-time experience.
Yeah, I guess I'm a sort of humanist, right? I kind of, at some level, I believe in bodies in relation to artworks, right? I think that there's something kind of concrete about that that's important, you know? And the work on many levels is kind of, I think, you know, a lot across the work, there's really a reflection on, I think one of the things that's happening in the work, like when you make a work that's about scientists speculating on the world of the future, or about the Chrysler Imperial, or about new sexual lifestyles, or about whatever, Jean-Paul Sartre, on some level, like, within that, there's a speculation on what are the kind of capabilities and limitations of this situation,
right,
as a gallery space. Is it possible for me, and is it possible for an audience, is it possible for us somehow, insofar as we're a collective, is it possible for us to talk about, to think about the sexual revolution in America circa 1973 in this context, and see it somehow in relation to our own context? I think by enacting these kind of, you know, references and drawing them in, there's all sorts of plays going on between what an artwork can speak of and what it can't speak of at a given moment under a given set of conditions. Do you know what I mean?
Yep, I do. Like, for example, in that series of photographs, the quite small-scale photographs that or like Americana, certain terms of, like, it's almost like in that you're subscribing to or making a vision of the past that is like was never there or didn't exist. And I think the implication is that we do that all the time in relation to the present, past, and the future, that we make versions of things through the media that we use within the cultural norms at the time. But there was a theological dimension to that work, was there?
Yeah. I was hoping you wouldn't bring that up. Just because it gets really complicated.
I think it goes to the idea of eternity and fixity. I think.
Yes, exactly. I mean, there's, you know, so that work, 1984 and beyond, which was in that IMA show a couple of years ago that Sean mentioned, I think that... at the core of the work is this video, which I showed you a little clip of. The actual video is like the best part of an hour long, so you can see you just got a very small fragment. But the video work's shown distributed across these three monitors, which sort of occupy the center of the space. And then on the walls, there's this frieze of black and white photographs on one side, and then there's a vinyl text, like a signage kind of vinyl text that's put on the wall in the same space, in another corner. And the text is a quotation from a biography of Jonathan Edwards, who was this 18th century American theologian. And the biography was written by a Harvard historian, Perry Miller, in the early 60s. And it zones in on this idea of Edwards, which was this idea of typology, which is, I don't know if there's any theologians in the audience, but typology is actually a concept that recurs in theology and Christian theology. It takes slightly different forms, as far as I understand, throughout the history of theology. But essentially what it comes down to is an idea that the world as it manifests around us is an iteration of the Bible, of the Old Testament. So an idea that somehow what we see is kind of somehow a literalization of the text, right? And in that sense, it kind of connects.
Yeah.
It connects to a lot of my work, to a methodology. I mean, I'm not religious, but I'm interested in history, and I'm interested in the history of theology. And then the photographs, I think, have an interesting role in relation to it because basically they're contemporary photographs, but what they do is, and they're made without any manipulation or staging or anything like that. They're very happenstantial in terms of how they're made. But what's very calculated about them is the way in which, as I said earlier, they try to paraphrase a certain history of mid-century American photography. I tried to photograph the things that those photographers photographed, right?
Yes.
And I tried to photograph the things in the same kinds of ways, with the same types of lenses and stuff like that, and make prints that look similar. In a dark room, again, no computer manipulation. And the idea is that what it shows, I think, is that actually the world looks the same now as it did in 1950.
Yeah.
If you look at it through a certain means, you know. And so that connects to the other elements of the work, I think, you know. Because the video is completely preoccupied by how much the world will change in the future. So there's a strange inversion.
Yeah. Like, is that series complete, those photographs, you say, or is that?
Well, what happened was originally I was started to make the photographs as kind of research for the project, and then they took on their own momentum as an idea, and then I took edited the selection of them, which I included in the installation with the video, because they played a strategic role, dialogical role with the video, where, as I said, they kind of counteract the video on some level. They say the opposite on some level of what the dialogue in the video says. But then I've actually continued to make the photographs. Me taking ownership on some level of my own work. And I've continued to sort of produce them. I travel to the US quite a lot. My wife's American. You know, and I spend a fair bit of time there, and the photographs are pretty much exclusively made there. And America's full of old stuff. That's actually what's quite interesting, you know, when you look around. I think we're tight on time.
Tight on time. Just, if I just ask you briefly about you teach in Copenhagen, you were saying. How do you find that? Is that
the teaching
tiring or?
I've got used to it, I suppose. Yeah. It is tiring. I mean, for a few years, when I started there in 2007, and the first few years, I sort of deluded myself that I could be superhuman, that somehow I could do that as well as kind of pursuing my practice to its fullest. And humility has kicked in, and I've realized that it works. It works generally, but we're not superhuman, right?
Yeah.
You give up stuff. To do that, you have to give up something else. But I will say, that sounds wistful, but I will say that actually it's been a great experience in terms of teaching. It's a very interesting school, the school in Copenhagen. It's very unique. It's very small. It's extremely old. Caspar David Friedrich is an alumni of the school. There's a whole pantheon of Danish and Nordic artists who are alums of the Academy in Copenhagen. And there's corners of it that still look exactly as they did in the 18th century. So it's quite special on some levels.
Yeah.
It's also, it's great. There's a lot of good, great students and and some great people teaching there as well. So I've been very privileged, I feel, to work there. It's been great. So,
But your own work is chiefly carried out in Dublin, is it?
I mean, I live here. My family are here. I have a studio here, not far from the gallery here, So here's my base. I've traveled, I've been quite sort of peripatetic over the last decade, and it's slowed down a little bit now because I have a kid and try to kind of opt out of a lot of traveling kind of requirements if I can. But it's sort of an inevitability. It's sort of an occupational hazard.
Yeah.
Of working as an artist. And actually, I also think it's something that a lot of people who don't know artists maybe mightn't realize is that actually somehow, I think contemporary artists are just always traveling. I mean, there's times when I've felt like traveling is my job, as if I'm like some sort of courier who's just meant to deliver stuff around the world. I've really had to put the brakes on it a little bit, and that feels good. So I'm here more. I like being here.
Do you have larger projects in hand at the moment?
I'm working right now on some things. The things that feel very most immediate are, a show in this house in Switzerland, the Villa Langmatt, which is it's actually a private villa that's late 19th century, early 20th century industrialist villa that's got an incredible, it was a private collection of impressionists and early modern work. They still have it all in this house, and it's open to the public now as a museum, and they're doing some contemporary art stuff. So I'm working on a group show there, which isn't such a big deal, but I'm also hoping to maybe film something there
later
in the year. And then otherwise, the main thing I'm working on then is I'm doing a survey show in France in early July in the Frac Pays de la Loire, which is going to be fun. It's a little bit like the Whitechapel scenario that I described, showing kind of, existing work and mostly, pretty much all, I'm not really making anything new for the show. But I'm quite, as I've explained, quite interested in making exhibitions and how they're made and how they function. And it's not just a kind of it's not like I just show up at the opening, right? And I'm in place. I'm heavily involved in, for want of a better term, exhibition design.
Yeah.
And so I'm quite involved in that right now as well. So they're the most immediate things.
Gerard, thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Aidan.
Thank you. I think there's time for questions, if anyone had a question. Yep.
Yeah, I think you know, I'm I had a response there. I think you know, I'm quite interested in theater, and I haven't talked that much about it tonight. I'm quite interested in theater. I go to the theater a bit. I'm not some sort of theater buff, but I'm interested in ideas of theater. I'm interested in what makes theater different, for example, to other artistic forms, right? So one of the things that's some of the things that are interesting to me about theater, and I think they speak to your question, is that I'm interested in a sort of provisional character to theater. It happens in front of your eyes, right? Even if it's very elaborate, you still have some sense of the mechanics of what you're looking at, right? In a way that you might not with film production, for example, some CGI kind of, who knows, Lord of the Rings, who knows how they made it, right? So there's something very immediate about theater, and there's something provisional about it that I think is very interesting. And also, I mean, theater is also interesting because it's, on some level, you might say that debatably the oldest art form, right? And something that certainly is very, very historically embedded. It's embedded in like the Greek epics and stuff like that. And so, so I see that in a way as a very interesting model for artistic practice, because both in its kind of historical kind of awareness, but also in its sense of immediacy, in its sense of the here and now. And that to me speaks to the idea of a gallery space, talks to the ideas I talked about earlier of, like, you know, the concreteness of the gallery space and the kind of immediacy of it. You're in the here and now in this space, right? And so, but there's a provisional quality to theater, which I think is also kind of really important. And I think that idea of the provisional, something that's put together and is not necessarily concerned with being completely convincing or being, you know, but has a sort of porousness to it, right? I think those qualities are useful and interesting. And I think that in a way that's, you know, I might not use the language that you've used to talk about my work, but I think we might be talking about something similar. Yeah. I mean, I think that when you go to theater, I think. You know, I think when you go to theater, I don't know if you really worry about, like, authenticity, right? It is what it is. It is authentic in the sense that it's right in front of your eyes, right? That makes it authentic. Whatever about the kind of character of the performances or, you know, anything else. Mm. And so its authenticity is in its kind of immediacy, right? And I think that probably holds with art. I mean, it's interesting that you picked up on the small black and white photographs that we've been talking about as being sort of duplicitous, because actually, I think that's very interesting, but actually they're really not duplicitous because they're completely unmanipulated. They're just, and they're completely straight up about what they are. But what's interesting is to realize that something that we assume should look really, really different actually doesn't. So on some level, they're really kind of straight up, and what they challenge, if anything, is our is the way we construct history as a history that's about difference and about change and about distanciation. And that connects maybe to this typology idea that the vinyl text, you know, which is, you know, where you can see that as a model of history. It's a model of history because it's an anti-history model, right? There is no, everything is the same as the Old Testament, nothing changes. It might look, it might manifest differently, but somehow it's always the Old Testament, right? It's just one model.
Yeah.
Do you have time for
it? You said you do a lot of traffic, and it reminds me of a poet years ago who said to me that I asked him where he lived, and he said that I live in three different places. Sometimes I stay with friends. And this was a deep way of saying that to get creativity moving, he often changed.
Yeah.
And then things have fell into place. Do you ever have to cope with drying up, and what do you do to get things moving again?
Yeah, good questions. It's difficult to find headspace. Really difficult to find headspace, and it seems like it's sort of increasingly difficult. And then somehow when you find it, it feels really obvious, right? On some level, like, so I do things like, when I'm smart, I just put on the headphones and just block everything out. Turn off the email, that's a killer, right? And it's all the usual stuff that I guess everybody has to do. Certainly it's really, really restorative to spend time looking at shows, going to see shows. Going to see shows, or, you know, looking at a movie, but going to see shows, I think, is something that I've increasingly found, like, it's kind of great. It's a great break from life, you know, and it's interesting, and, you know, been enjoying that recently. So, and it allows you to think about the stuff that you want to be thinking about. I think we're out of time, are we?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, we're going to have to call a halt. This has been just a fascinating evening. And huge thanks to Gerard Byrne and to Aidan Dunne. Wonderful interview, wonderful conversation. Thanks to all of you. And can we welcome you over to the restaurant for a glass of wine to continue the conversation? Thank you all.